2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 1. Let's all stand. 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse number 1. I'm glad you're here tonight. I don't want to take it for granted that you come out of your house and come to God's house on a Sunday night, and you had a choice to make. Whether or not to come to God's house or stay away. And I certainly am glad that you're here. And 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 1. Now I, Paul, myself beseech you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ, who in presence am base among you, but being absent am bold towards you. But I beseech you that I may not be bold when I am present with that confidence, wherewith I think to be bold against some, which think of us as if we walk according to the flesh. And I want you to let the words kind of sink down into who you are and get in tune with the scripture here. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations, and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, in having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Now, we just read six verses, and there's a lot of truth in these six verses. So here's what I'm going to do. It's going to be a little bit unusual for me on a Sunday night. I'm going to go verse by verse, and I'm going to give you the teaching of the verse, and they will build. And then I'll give you the truth at the very end, four truths that I think will help all of us. I'm preaching tonight on this subject, winning the real battle. Winning the real battle. And let's pray. Heavenly Father, as I have asked you for weeks now with these thoughts and this passage of scripture, Lord, work on my heart as I preach. And Lord, I'm going to ask you to work on everybody else's heart as I preach. And Lord, may we walk out of here as a church, primarily, and then as a family of God, secondarily, may we leave here more committed and being able to understand what it takes to win the battles in our lives. I pray for the moms and dads that they would be encouraged tonight. I pray for the young men and the young ladies that they would see marching orders tonight for their life. I pray that everybody would take responsibility. Thank you, Lord, for what our eyes have seen, our ears have heard, our hearts have felt on this very day. And Lord, as we go into the Thanksgiving week, may we say thank you for giving us a church that we can come to. Bless now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. May be seated. I want you to let your eyes rest on verse number 1 and verse number 2. And we're just going to march right down these verses, but I'm going to be making comments in between the verses, so I need you to kind of tune in to the comments. It's a little bit different because we are accustomed to point 1, point 2, point 3 more than I think sometimes we need to be, because it's not the points that necessarily bring success. It is the words of God that bring success. So let's get into the Bible. Verse number 1 and verse number 2, he says this, "Now I, Paul, myself beseech you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ, who in the presence am base among you, but being absent am bold towards you. But I beseech you that I may not be bold when I am present with that confidence wherewith I think to be bold against some, which think of us as if we walk according to the flesh." Paul. It was very important to Paul that the Christians at the church of Corinth did not get the wrong impression about Paul. He did not want them to think that the boldness that they heard from him and the gentleness that they saw in him, that this successful Christian life that he was living, he did not want them to think that it was because of what they saw. He did not want them to think that it was the flesh that brought this confidence, and he did not want them to think that it was the meekness and the humility that brought this successful Christian life. Paul was very, very keen, and it was very important to Paul that nobody looked at Paul and saw the outer man and thought to them, "Wow, that's how you win the Christian life. That's how you do the Christian life." It wasn't wrapped up in a style. It wasn't wrapped up in what he wore. It wasn't wrapped up in how he walked. It wasn't wrapped up in how he carried himself. Can I stop right here and just tell you this? You do not win the Christian life by imitating the outer that you see of man. There are people that you and I respect in the Christian faith that we look at and we say, now they got it all together. Now they are the epitome of the Christian life. But Paul was the epitome of the Christian life to these people back here. He wrote him 2 and 3 letters, and he was very, very bold toward some of them, and he chastised the church, so he was well respected. But it was very important to Paul that he told them, my respect for me, don't let the respect for me come from what you see in the flesh. That's very important. You know, we can get wrapped up in it's the style of glasses, or it's the style of clothes, or it's the shoes that somebody wears, or it's the kind of car that somebody drives, and that's why they're the successful Christian. You listen to me. It's not what you see on the outside that makes somebody a successful Christian. And Paul wanted them to know my confidence, my boldness, my meekness, my gentleness, my baseness, my exuberance doesn't come because of the flesh. Now go to verse 3. For though we walk in the flesh, look at it, we do not war after the flesh. You know what he was saying? What you see on the outside when you look at us walking in the flesh, do not think that this is the battlefield of the Christian life. The flesh is not the battlefield. It is not where the war is won in the Christian life. You and I can get sucked into this theology that says this, well, you know, as long as you look good on the outside, you're winning the war of the Christian life. That's not true. That's not true. And he was very important to him that he said, now look at me, Christians at Corinth. We may walk after the flesh, but that's not where the war is at. The war is not what you see of me on the outside. The war is not the flesh. Keeping the hair short is not the battle. Keeping the flesh straight is not the battle. Keeping the flesh out of places is not where the battle is. Keeping the flesh from disgracing is not where the battle is. In fact, I have this highlighted in my notes. This is going to shock you. There are people in this room that their flesh is in sadder shape than most, but they are living more of a victorious Christian life. Say that again. There are people sitting in this auditorium that their flesh is in a sadder shape than most, but they are more victorious in the Christian life. Because we judge too much based on what is happening on the outside rather than focusing and knowing this, that the war that is won on the inside just hasn't showed up yet on the outside. There are people sitting, there are people coming to our church. Isn't it sad that churches judge pillars of the church by what we see on the outside? But if there's any semblance of good on the outside, let me tell you, any semblance of good that you see in Bob Gray's flesh only happened because I won the war on the inside days ago. If you ever see this flesh start to decay and start to disgrace my wife and disgrace my family, then you know this, that the decay you see on the flesh is only because I lost the real war years ago on the inside. As long as I understand we walk after the flesh, but we do not war after the flesh, and the real war tonight is not the war on the outside, it is the war on the inside that you and I have got to be very, very careful that we fight every day. Do not think because your flesh has arrived to safety that there still is no war. Just because your flesh has made it to look good, and just because your flesh has made it to make you look like a Christian, doesn't mean that you don't fight the battle. So Paul was telling them in verse 1 and 2, my boldness, my confidence is not because of the flesh, so don't play it off with the flesh. My boldness and my confidence is not because I've been warring after the flesh. We walk of the flesh, but we don't war after the flesh. Look at verse 4. For the weapons of our warfare are not what? Carnal, but mighty through God in the pulling down of what? Strongholds. You know what he was saying here? That the weapons that are used in the inner battle that we are fighting are not carnal weapons on the outside. Case in point. The Bible is very clear that a man is to have short hair. The Bible's very clear about that. That is like non-negotiable. Do we understand that? Non-negotiable. But we must be careful that we do not say that the war is the long hair. The war is not the long hair. The war is the heart that would embrace manhood, that would cut the hair first on the inside, that it shows up on the outside. The inner battle is what every man has to fight when it comes to honoring or dishonoring the short hair verse. But don't look at people with long hair and think to yourself, oh, they're not the kind of Christian they need to be. No, the battle they're fighting on the inside just hasn't shown up yet on the outside. Last Sunday night, I had one of the most amazing conversations after church. I had got done baptizing, I think it was, or coming out of the auditorium last Sunday night. And I was headed down the hallway to my office, and there was a young man, a new believer, that was standing there. And he said, hey, Pastor, can I talk to you? And I said, absolutely. We walked into my office in there, and we shut the door, and he looked at me, and he just started telling me how much the sermon meant to him last Sunday night. And with tears in his eyes, he said, Pastor, he said, I fight so many battles on the inside. And with tears in his eyes, he said, but I want to be the right kind of Christian. Now, on the outside, you had him beat hands down. But I wonder if on the inside he had you beat hands down. Because the war is not what we see on the outside. The war is what we don't see on the inside. So the real war, you cannot judge how the war's going today by what I see on the outside. I can only judge how the war went today by what I see on the outside weeks from right now. That's why you take some teenagers and they're in the church and they look good on the outside, but boy, you let graduation happen and you let the turning of the tassel happen, and all of a sudden their flesh goes to the devil and their life goes to the devil. Why? Because they were losing the inner war their sophomore, junior, and senior year, and nobody was smart enough to say, hey, what about the inner war? How are you doing in the most important war? And that war, the most important war, is on the inside. And that's why Paul was telling the Corinthians, he was saying, look, don't judge me by what you see on the outside. My boldness and my confidence that I have to tell you to get rid of the man who's being immoral, the boldness and the confidence that I have to tell you not to fall for false religion, doesn't come because of the flesh. It comes because of the war that I'm fighting on the inside, and the weapons of my warfare are not man-made, and the weapons of my warfare you can't buy at Walmart, and the weapons of my warfare you can't buy at Bass Pro Shop, and you can't buy Gander Mountain. You can't buy it there. You must find those wars at the feet of Jesus. In fact, go back and look at the verse. He says, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but what? Mighty through who? God. You say, well, why didn't he list the weapons? Because you don't need a list, or you would man make them. You need God. And God's the one that tells you, here's the weapon that you need to use. God is the one that tells you, here's the battle, here's the weapon. Here's the battlefield, here's the weapon. Here's what you're fighting, here's the weapon. Here's what you're going through, here's the weapon. And we are crazy if we think that the flesh is where we're supposed to war at. Oh no, my friend, the flesh is just the battle remains of what the real war's been doing on the inside. Anybody who gets themselves in trouble in the flesh, it all started with losing the battle on the inside. So you know where the real war is at tonight? It's not you staying awake during the preaching. The real war is what's going on in your heart. Now go to verse number 5. Here it is. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Paul is telling them in verse number 5 that you are to cast down the imagination in every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God. He is telling them in verse number 5, now look at your Bibles, he's telling them in verse number 5, that go back to verse number 4, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of what? Strongholds. The strongholds mentioned in verse 4 are nothing more than what the imaginations created in verse 5. You see, when your imagination gets started and it goes unchecked and it goes unfiltered, then that's what creates strongholds. So he's telling them, whatever strongholds you are battling, the war to fight those strongholds are not found in the flesh. They are found in the inner war that goes on, and the only weapons that will fight the strongholds are those weapons by God that throws down the imagination and casts down. But he also goes on to say this, look at it, and bringing into what? Captivity. Every what? Thought to the obedience of Christ. Now, it's just not good enough. Now please listen to me because I'm headed somewhere. When you're fighting this inner war, it's not good enough to cast down the wrong imaginations and thoughts. It's not good enough to say no to the imaginations and thoughts. You must now take those imaginations and thoughts and make them captive. And you must make those thoughts obedient to Christ. You know what he was saying? You fight the inner war. You use God's weapons to fight the inner war. And then when your imagination starts exalting itself against the knowledge of God, then you not only cast it down, but you quickly bind it and bring it into captivity. If you would bear with me, I'll illustrate this. And CJ, I'm going to use you because you're skinnier than I am, and I think I can whoop you. And let me see your belt, if you don't mind. And literally whoop you. And so if CJ is the imagination, Paul was trying to tell them that as you're fighting this war, you're not fighting in the flesh. Your battle is not when you mess up in the flesh. You got to back it all up. The battle's got to be here. In anything that exalts itself, and we're going to let this chair represent the knowledge of God, anything that starts to exalt itself above the knowledge of God, so keep walking up, and all of a sudden it becomes preeminent. God says, Paul was telling them, you're not only to cast it down, but you are literally to make it your prisoner and make sure that imagination and that thought now is brought to obedience to Christ. Kneel down. And you do not leave anybody roaming in your mind and heart that is not obedient to Christ. You see, many people try to say no. Christ said, that's not how we win the inner war. We just don't say no to the bad thoughts and the bad imaginations. You know what we do? We cast it down, then we go take it captive, and we make it obey Christ. You say, why do these imaginations and things keep coming back to me? Because we don't understand that the real war is not the flesh. The real war is what's going on in here. The real war is what's going on up here. And he said, you bring them into captivity. Look at verse 6. And having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience, when your obedience is fulfilled. So the key to casting down and bringing into captivity is that every bad thought is this. Are you ready? And having in a readiness to a revenge. Please listen to me. You no longer can go through the day and through your life going, well, I'll deal with what comes my way and just roll over. You have to be ready. You have to be ready to get it when it makes its first step. You can't wait for it to exalt itself. Go ahead and walk all the way. You can't wait for it to exalt itself, because if it gets above the knowledge of God, it's going to come out in your flesh. At that point, you've got to apologize. And at that point, You've got to make excuses. And at that point, you're in trouble. And at that point, your wife's disappointed in you. And at that point, your husband's disappointed. And at that point, mom and dad are disappointed in you. Listen to me. We've got to win the war before that thought and that imagination gets out in that flesh. And you, every successful Christian you see is not successful because of what you see in the flesh. It's successful because behind the sinews and the bone on the inner man is a war that they are constantly fighting every day. Fighting because they know if those thoughts and those imaginations ever get above God in my life, it'll come out in my flesh. So I have to be ready. Come all the way back down. I have to be ready that when it even takes the first step, go ahead, CJ, first step that I'm like, oh, no. Now you are going to kneel before Christ. And you are going to think the way he wants you to think. You win that war here, it won't come out your mouth. You know what screaming mamas are? Hateful mamas, cussing mamas. Nothing more than mamas who didn't win the war on the inside first. Do you know what teenage guys and teenage girls that are out of control? They're only teenagers who didn't win the war here first. Do you know what lustful men and men who act out on passion outside the bounds of marriage, which should never be? They're nothing more than men who didn't win the war here first. You've got to win it here first. Let me give you four things and five things and I'm done. Number one, the condition of your flesh right now is the result of your mind yesterday. The condition of your flesh right now. I have no idea what that is. Is that you, Brother Queen? Okay, the condition of your flesh right now, I've never had anybody admit to it. You're the very first one to ever. Everybody else is sort of looking around, pointing at other people. And boy, that's security with your cell phone right there. Good thing it wasn't your Elvis songs. And so, never mind. That's funny. Now, that's funny. Or do we have to go back further than that, right? Noah and the ark. And so, where was I? Your cell phone right now is a result of you not turning it on silent. The condition of your flesh right now is the result of your mind yesterday. Let me ask you a question. What has your flesh gotten you into? It's nothing more than you didn't win the battle back there. It's all a result. Next, the confidence for the Lord in the flesh is because you won the battle on the inside. The confidence for the Lord in the flesh is because you won the battle on the inside. My Stone Arrington, we were on the soul winning bus this past week, and where's Stone at? Stone, I'm not going to have you do it. But he was leading a song. I was sitting there going, how does someone that short and that skinny have that much guts to get up there and lead a song? And I'm thinking to myself, I have never laughed so hard in my life. The thing that made me laugh was not Stone necessarily leading the song. It was his peers that were cracking up at him leading the song. And I thought to myself, where does a young man get that much boldness to jump up there and lead the song like he is just going to town? You want to know why? Because Stone wins the war on the inside, thus he has the confidence on the outside to get out there and do something for the Lord. That's why the younger our children are, the more we better give them a head start on winning that war. The more we better understand, we better guard their heart, for out of it come the issues of life. That's why when I was standing up there baptizing those two young ladies, I thought to myself, what pleasant looks on their faces. You want to know why? Mom, aunt, because they've not lost the war on the inside. That's why they look so great on the outside. But you take us adults, come on now, your kids are happier than you are. These little kids are crazy now. And that's all there is to it. Friday, I was going through the school, and I guess it was gum day at the school. I'm not quite sure. Is that right? Gum day at the school. So I stepped in, and they're giving me all these gums. So I'm like stuffing them in my mouth, one after the other. And I got this big wad of gum that I'm chomping down on. And then Haley Rousseau, she says, try this, and gives me this dumbest sour thing I've ever, toxic sour. It, like, you know, you're old when it starts, the acid. Come on, how many are right there with me? The acid starts right there, and you feel like, I am going to throw up. This is so too much, and I had to spit it out. They, listen to me, do you know why we enjoy our kids and why I love our church? I'll tell you why and why I love our families. It's because we understand that they've got to keep the inside winning that war so they can have the confidence on the outside to do what God wants them to do. Next, number three, be prepared every day to go to war. Be prepared every day to go to war. Be prepared every day to go to war. Guys, don't wake up and fool yourself. Tomorrow morning, you're going to see something that's going to try to become bigger than God in your life. Get ready. Cast it down. Bring that thought into the obedience of Jesus Christ. Ladies, get ready. Something's going to happen that's going to try to exalt itself against God. You cast it down. Bring it into captivity. Bring it to the Jesus Christ, into the throne of God. Fighting the inner battle, next, fighting the inner battle will keep the flesh from becoming a casualty. Fighting the inner battle will keep the flesh from becoming a casualty. Divorce is a part of our society. It is sad. It does happen. But I know good people that were dishonored in their marriage, and it just didn't work out. Can I tell you something? It's needless sometimes, because if somebody would have just won the war on the inside, if they just would have taken the time to win the war on the inside, then a lot of things could be prevented. And those of you that have never gone through that, win the war now. Win the war now. And I'll tell you where it starts. There is a reason why God did not use. Go back to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. I thought to myself as I was studying this portion of Scripture, I thought, man, Paul was pretty right on target by telling the Corinthians, it's not the flesh. Don't look at my flesh and think this is how you need to act to win a war. We don't walk after the flesh. You need to go to God to get the weapons. But then he uses the word in verse number 5 under the inspiration of the Almighty. He uses the word imagination. If you'll get ready, Brother Newland, he uses the word imagination. Now, when he used the word imagination, I thought to myself, why didn't he just use the word thought? Why didn't God use the word thought? Why imagination? And when you break down the word imagination, you have the word image. It is truly the word that means this, that we are so smart that we can compute quickly. For instance, are you ready? Go ahead and push the space bar. 2 + 15 × 3 − 10 equals stop. What? Hit it. 41. How many knew that? Your brain did. Okay. It's your imagination. Boy, I hope they got these right. Let me tell you something. I'm sitting here sweating it myself. You know, when you do it and you do it and you do it, and it's like, okay, this better be right. Are you ready? Here we go. Let's see how smart your imagination is. Next. Right? 9 + 3 + 10 × 12 equals answer. How many have no idea, because once you got to 12, you never passed that part in school? Go ahead, hit it. 264. How many knew that? How many are smart enough to know that? And I hate you too. All right? That's your mind. Do you have any idea that the devil knows how God made you? And Paul knew. He said, let me tell you something. Your war is not in the flesh. Your flesh is just a casualty or the victor based on what's going on in the inside of you. And your imagination is smart to where it can compute quickly. It can get to the end of where it needs to be. It computes. Then the word imagination also gives us the ability to see the picture by just one little reveal. Go to the next one, please. So here's what we're going to do. As soon as you think you know what the picture is, then just holler. Are you ready? You've always wanted to holler in church. What is it? Tibbs logo. Keep going. Now, how did They know that. Tell you why. They've seen that crest 1,000 times. Go to the next one. Tithing envelope. Keep going. Don't be shocked. It's a tithing envelope. Now, do you know why Brother Rousseau knew exactly what it was? And some of you, you've seen it every week. Do you know why some of you still haven't figured out what it is? Back it all the way up, very first screen. So I'm going to ask you this week to start winning the war on the inside, and as soon as your imagination goes 2K plus 15 times 3 minus equals, stop right there. As soon as you figure out that what it equals is going to hurt you, shut it down. Shut it down. You already know what the answer is going to be. Just don't let it get in your imaginations. Don't let it get seed. If you already know, it's not going to be good. Go past the equations. Go to the very first picture with the crest. So even when you know, keep going, Brother Newland. Even when you know, stop. At the moment, you know. Oh, you don't even have to uncover the rest of it. I know exactly what it is. I know exactly how this is going to go. Stop it then. You have to fight the war on the inside. You can't wait until you have the whole picture. When you knew, go ahead and put the whole thing up. When you knew what it would be at the very first revealing. We are so dumb as to think, well, I'm big enough, I can handle the whole picture. Nobody in this room can handle the whole picture of evil. We've got to be smarter than that. And Paul said this, don't you look at a successful Christian and think to yourself, they're winning the battle by how they dress and how they walk and how they act and what they wear. They won the battle long before that on the inside, and they won it in the fight over anything that would exalt itself against the knowledge of God. Let me give you three things I think you're going to need. Number one, you have to have knowledge to know what to reject. You have to have knowledge to know what to reject. So how do you fight this war? You fight it with your eyes in the Word of God. Start getting the knowledge. Start getting the knowledge. And by the way, don't follow man's opinion and don't follow man's theory. You follow God's word. I taught it this morning in Sunday school, and I believe it, that the main source of truth is God's word. You and I have got to be feasters of God's word. You say, well, I have no idea what I'm going to face. Listen to me. God knows what you're going to face. God knows what you're going to face. You put enough word in you, God will bring it to remembrance what you need. You have to have knowledge in order to know what to reject. Number two, you have to have communion. You have to have communion in order to have passion. Let me tell you something. You have to spend time with your Lord. When is the last time you got out and just talked with the Lord? I mean, took a drive. When's the last time you took who you were? And by the way, go backwards, if you will, and just reveal just the first part of the crest. Can I tell you something? It's you going, oh, dear God, oh, I don't want to be that. I don't even want to be that. God, I don't even want to go there. Lord, you and I got to talk. It's that communion with God. Communion. You've got to have it. Then the third thing is this, accountability. 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 You got to have it. Do you know, I think the men become weak when the marriage becomes weak. I don't think men start off wanting to be this weak individual. I think they don't have a close connect with their wife. I think a teenager that goes down this path is because he doesn't have that kind of relationship with his parents. I think that a young lady that fills the void with a young man and does things that they shouldn't do is because they don't have that dad. I think that a young man that explores where he shouldn't explore is because him and dad are not as close as they need to be. There is something about accountability. There is something about having somebody in your life that you can sit down with and say, hey, can I talk to you about that? Because I don't want to be what the rest of that picture shows. And I need your help because I want to be who I need to be. Don't fight this inner war by yourself. Fight the inner war. Let somebody help you. That's why you got a pastor. That's why you have a husband. That's why you have a wife. That's why you have a parent. That's why you have a Sunday school teacher. That's why you have somebody who means something to you. Invest in them. Confide in them. Ask them for your help, for their help. That's why dating couples, can I tell you something? I think it's a foolish dating relationship that doesn't have somebody helping them. And I'm not picketing right now for the job. That's not the issue. The issue is this. Find somebody who's godly. Find somebody who's older. Somebody has a good marriage and say, would you help our dating relationship? Don't do this by yourself. If you're a husband and you say, I want to be the right kind of husband, then find a husband and ask for help. There are different stages that you go through. You have to have somebody to help you. And I think the combination between the knowledge of God and a passion for God and then a human being like Paul that says this, your battle is not after the flesh. Your battle is not a carnal battle. Your battle is a spiritual battle that only God can give you the right weapons to beat. Let me ask you a question. Are you losing this battle? Right now on the inside of who you are you just rolling over and playing dead, or are you fighting? Let me tell you something. If you're saved tonight, then you've got the power on the inside to fight it. Now fight it. Rise up. Grab a good old dose of God and go to fighting. Don't roll over and play dead. Don't sit here a victim. Don't suck your thumb. Don't go to the nursery of life. Get up and fight a little bit. And tomorrow morning, you say, I'm winning this war on the inside. I'm ready. I'm ready. I'm going to fight it. I'm not going to play like I'm a little boy. I'm going to play like a man. Fight it. Because if you don't, please listen to me, you'll lose. But you're not the one who loses. Everybody around you loses. Here's where some of you are tonight, and I'm done. Stand up. Some of you, it's coming, go above. Here's God has exalted itself above the knowledge of God. And now it's coming out in your marriage. It's coming out in your body. It's coming out in your language. It's coming out in your music. It's coming out in your entertainment. And you're just destroying yourself. Where do I fix it? Start fighting the battle on the inside. And I promise you, you'll win it. Thank you, CJ. Have a seat. Oh, that hurts me. Are you the kind of Christian right now that you truly are putting more of an emphasis on the outside? Or are you putting the right emphasis on the inside? You say, but I look good. Nobody would ever know. Well, let me tell you something. If you don't win that battle on the inside, they'll know. They'll know. Let me flip it rather than being negative. I'm excited for some of you. There are some people that attend our church that they struggle. Oh, my goodness, they struggle. I was asked, a dear lady, if I could use this in my illustration right now as I'm closing. And she said, yes, you can use it. Just don't use my name. And I said, okay. I was making a visit this past week and happened to go see a couple. And I couldn't find the wife. And so I was talking with the husband, and I was counseling with him. And then I said, well, where's your wife? And maybe I can bring her up to speed. And he goes, I don't know. I don't know where she's at. She's somewhere. And I said, well, you mind if I go look for her? And he said, yeah, go look for her. She's probably, yeah. And I said, okay. So I went to look for her. Walked around the corner. And she's got that cigarette in her mouth. And when she saw me, she was like, trying to hold it in. And I'm just saying, they go, hey, how you doing? Finally, it just came out. She said, wouldn't you know it? Wouldn't you know it? Wouldn't you know it? The only time I struggle and get nervous is when we go to counseling. And the only way I can relieve this is by smoking. And wouldn't you know it, you would have to walk around the corner. And I said, you know, you're just fine. And listen to what she said. She said, Pastor, it is such a battle, but I'm going to win it. You know, I thought to myself, may every Christian feel that way, not smoke that way, feel that way. May every Christian go, I'm going to fix it. I'm going to win the battle on the inside. I'm going to get this done. I'm going to be better than what I was yesterday. I may not look like much on the outside, but I'm going to win the battle on the inside. And may we just keep progressing. And that's why you and I need to keep our mouth off of people that don't measure up to our standard. Can I just say this publicly? Nobody makes the Longview Baptist Temple look bad. I am not ashamed of any of its members or any of its attendees. We got a couple people waiting to join right now. They said, as soon as I can measure up, I'm going to join. I said, nobody measures up, just join. Well, I don't want to embarrass your church. You can't embarrass our church. Because we're doing a good enough job of it ourselves. Come on. Win the war on the inside. And watch what happens on the outside. Heavenly Father, I sure...